Welcome to the BioBalance Healthcast, episode number 440. Cholesterol doesn't mean a thing. A picture is worth a thousand words. BioBalance Health features conversations about anti-aging medicine. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health, and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about testosterone replacement therapy for women, and Got Testosterone, the newly released book for men that helps men choose the most effective and safe form of T replacement. These books are available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health in St. Louis and in Kansas City. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients. The number that the cholesterol number, LDL and HDL, that I get from my blood tests always somewhat confuse me. But the doctors are always ecstatic because my numbers are wherever they think they should be. But I don't understand. But that seems to be the primary focus when they look at forecasting whether or not I'm going to have heart attacks or strokes, issues and concerns. And that's the only thing that we've ever talked about. And I have blood pressure issue that's a genetic one, and I'm on some medicine for it, and they track that, but they track it mostly in response to the cholesterol numbers. And the blood pressure medicine that I am on is not a statin, which seems to be the go-to blood pressure medicine for most docs.
Statins aren't blood pressure medicines.
Okay, then I'm wrong about
that. They're two different drugs.
All right.
Blood pressure is a factor, high blood pressure is a factor in developing heart disease if it's uncontrolled. But if you're on a medication and you have controlled your blood pressure down to normal, then that takes you out of the risk blood pressure causing you to have heart disease. But all doctors usually think about, because they don't have a lot of time, and when you walk in their office, they look at a few factors. They look at your blood count, which is just like, do you have enough iron? Do you have enough red blood cells? Do you have leukemia or lymphoma, by looking at the blood test? Or are you sick? Is your white count high? Then they look at your blood sugar. Do you have diabetes or not? And then they scan down to look at your cholesterol. And that is the one test they do to see if you're at risk for heart disease, which is... It's a fallacy. If you think that because you have good cholesterol, you can eat, smoke, get obese, and just completely not take care of yourself, that's ridiculous, because cholesterol isn't the primary determinant as to whether you're going to get heart disease or not. There are plenty of people, like in our family, my husband's been on a statin for high cholesterol since he was 40, and he's 68, and he still has plaque on his blood vessels because we took a picture. We took a picture.
You know this because you took
it. I know this because we took a picture of his heart.
Right.
So you can actually, you don't have to sit around and worry, oh, I have high cholesterol, am I going to have a heart attack? Which is not necessarily an A leads to B. You can look with a two-shot CT scan called a cardiac calcium scan and see if you have plaque. So it's a definitive test. Do you have plaque on your blood vessels? So we did this. He's been on a statin. He does have controlled high blood pressure, but he still has plaque. So I, on the other hand, have familial high cholesterol. I have never been on a statin. I actually have the genetics that say that statins would damage my muscles. So I've done that test, and I can't take it. I won't take it. So I haven't been on it, so I had the same test. I had it when I was 48. And I had it again now when I'm 64. And I have no plaque. So my high cholesterol doesn't mean anything. Why should you worry about a factor that says, oh, you're going to have high cholesterol, you're going to have a heart attack because you have this? Mm-hmm. Why should you take a drug your whole life if this is not something that you are going to develop? It is not leads to B.
Why do they think that?
Well...
Because I've heard it all my adult life that's what you have to watch for heart disease.
Well, we don't treat diseases until we have a drug to treat them with. It's just like with osteoporosis. No one talked about osteoporosis until we had Fosamax and then the other drugs that followed. We didn't test for osteoporosis as OBGYNs when I trained because there was no drug to really treat osteoporosis except hormones, except estrogen. So we developed, we then started looking at this disease because we had something to treat it with. So they developed statins.
It's like the law of the hammer.
I know.
In psychology, we talk about the law of the hammer, which is if you give a three-year-old a hammer, everything is a nail.
I know. I realize how ridiculous this sounds.
Yeah.
But it's true. I mean, this is absolutely how new modern medicine works. We start looking for things that we now have a solution to, and then we use it on everybody.
Right.
We
one
don't,
size fits
we,
all.
One size fits all. Here, let's put it in the water. In fact, I've even heard that from doctors, which, I mean, it's not a benign drug. I mean, statins are not a benign drug. Fosamax is not a benign drug for osteoporosis.
Meaning that there are negative side effects.
There are negative side effects and serious ones. For statins, if you have a certain genetic makeup, and that test isn't done very often, but a certain genetic makeup, you can actually have it, it causes your muscles to dissolve, basically, and causes terrible pain. And once you stop the statin, it doesn't stop dissolving your muscles. So it's a very damaging disease.
But you track that and see whether or not you're having that effect. I mean, if John's been on it for 28 years, you track to see if that's a cause.
Well, he would know. He would have terrible pain in his muscles all over. He would, you know, it would be something that he wouldn't be able to build muscle mass.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there are signs that you have this. Usually it's pain.
So you and your doctor then could figure out what to do instead.
Right. So here's where I believe statin should be used. It should be that you have a problem. And specifically for that problem, we're going to treat it, right? So statins were made and are approved for people who have plaque on their blood vessels to slow the accumulation of plaque or to stop the accumulation in some cases. And for people who have had heart disease and have had strokes and who have diabetes because they're at higher risk of getting plaque on their blood vessels. With high blood sugar, you get more plaque.
Okay.
So those are the people that should be taking a statin.
Mm-hmm.
If you just have high cholesterol and your doctor says you need to take a statin,
So it's a calculated risk. If I have a plaque buildup, I'm already at risk for a heart disease issue, a stroke
right.
or a heart attack. If I take a statin, I might be at risk for some other consequence mm-hmm. and I might not.
Right.
Or I might have a grace period where the statin can protect me from my heart condition long enough for something else to, you know, kill me.
Or some other solution comes up.
Yeah, so the whole water.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the proper use then of
statin? That's a proper use of
a statin. If you have
a
known heart condition.
A known problem.
Not just high cholesterol.
So,
okay.
So I find that testing people for something, I mean, I still test people for cholesterol tests. I mean, even if they've never had a heart problem, even if they've never had a stroke, I look at it in a different way. On women, I don't look at total cholesterol at all. It doesn't mean anything because it's good cholesterol and bad cholesterol.
Explain that, please. What is good and why is it good? What's bad and why is it bad?
So total cholesterol is a combination of the measurement of LDL, low-density lipoproteins. Those are dangerous. They get into the blood vessel and make plaque. That, I mean, it's a lot more complicated than this. This is simplistic. But the other factor that they put into the formula that gives you a total cholesterol number is HDL, which is a big, big cholesterol that doesn't get into the vasculature, doesn't cause plaque. In fact, protects your vessels from plaque. So here's what doesn't make sense. Into this formula, they add, it's not a subtracting thing, they add it together, use a multiplier, and come up with your total cholesterol.
Okay.
That is good plus bad. What would that mean?
But on my blood test, it'll say LDL, and then it'll say HDL.
Right, but you look at the total, and that's what everybody goes, oh my God, my cholesterol's high. Well, the total really doesn't mean much. Because if you have a very high HDL, the good one, your total cholesterol will be high. And there's a lot of women with high HDLs that protect them from heart disease. It does play a role in heart disease, but it's not the only role. So it does protect them from heart disease, even if they have a slightly high LDL. But when they look at the total cholesterol, it looks high. So that's not a reason to be upset or worried. That's a reason to say, thank God I have a good HDL and it's protecting me and I don't need to lower it, because if you take a statin, it lowers the good one and the bad one. So that's not a good solution for that type of person.
If you don't have high cholesterol numbers, which I don't, and you
meaning
don't.
Meaning LDL.
I think, I guess.
No, the bad one is LDL. So if I'm looking at a cholesterol, I don't even look at the total. I just look at LDL to see if it's high.
All right.
And they've now, it's so interesting, now all of a sudden under the advice of the drug companies, they've lowered the normal cholesterol down to LDL to 100, whereas normally 130 and below is normal and is not at risk, once again, unless you've already had a heart attack. So they've lowered the normal. So whenever they want to have more people on a drug, they lower the normal. And everybody follows.
Yeah.
I mean, it is not good for us the way we're managing or way we're diagnosing.
So it's not a simplistic one test, one number, one drug solution.
Right. Or it's not a one test, oh, I'm fine. I can do whatever I want.
Right.
It shouldn't make you sleep at night because your cholesterol is okay if your blood sugar's high and your inflammation's high. So here's what causes plaque. There's two kinds of plaque: hard plaque, which is like calcium plaque, and plaque takes the blood vessel and it lines it so that the blood vessel has a little teeny tiny kind of avenue to push your blood through. So it narrows the blood vessel by making it thicker. So that's what hard plaque does, and it makes the vessel stiff. So it can't if you need more blood to exercise, it can't dilate. Because it's now a hard pipe instead of a soft vessel.
Or you have an exciting situation where your adrenaline sends out signals to say surge and your blood pressure surges to respond in that flight or fight mechanism. Mm-hmm. If your blood vessels are stiff, then they're more likely to just splinter.
Yeah, they are. Or have an embolism, like some of that plaque can come off and then actually block the blood vessels. So basically when we're trying to protect our vessels by protecting ourselves from plaque, thinking it's just cholesterol. But cholesterol is always in your bloodstream. It makes your brain, it makes all the cell walls in your body. You need cholesterol for your hair, for your skin, for all of your organs. And most importantly in my world, you need it to make your sex hormones. So you need it to make testosterone and estrogen. So cholesterol is what that is, they are made out of. So basically, you need cholesterol. You always have it. We have plenty of cholesterol when we're young as well. And basically, what happens is the cholesterol sticks to the blood vessel when you have inflammation. Inflammation is some kind of an infection or a reaction or an autoimmune disease.
So as we have these conversations weekly, you consistently come back to that theme, that the real danger that we need to be aware of and find ways to track. I mean, you have evidence that you can find that says, I have an inflammation issue somewhere.
Right. We look
but
for a CRP.
But you can't tell where it is.
Right. We look for a general inflammation throughout our bodies.
CRP is?
CRP is a way to measure inflammation. It's a chemical that goes up in your body when you have inflammation.
Okay. And so that's significant to you as a medical concern. If somebody has an inflated CRP, that means their body has inflammation somewhere. It could be in their knees, their hips, their wherever.
Mm-hmm.
And they're more likely then to have negative health consequences?
Yes.
Are they specific? Is it like a heart attack or is it?
Well, it affects a lot of different things.
Okay.
Inflammation has a lot of intracellular activities which are damaging to your ability of your cells to actually use oxygen. We talked about mitochondria a few weeks ago.
Right.
So it works inside our cells, but it also causes white cells to go out and try to find something to fix.
Yeah.
And so the white cells go out and they make prostaglandins, and prostaglandins then are sticky. And they stick the fat in your blood to your blood vessel. So if you have chronic inflammation, not just, oh, you hurt your knee and for a week you have inflammation, or you had the flu, you'll have inflammation with that too. But right. chronic inflammation, day in and day out inflammation, is going to cause you to have your blood vessels lined with more cholesterol.
So
that is really the problem is inflammation, not the cholesterol itself. It's what the inflammation does to the cholesterol to stick to the wall.
So this, in a nutshell, encapsulates the conversation that we have all the time about, as the population bubble in the United States is aging,
mm-hmm.
the approach of medicine to the practice of medicine needs to be refocused.
Yes.
Because historically, it's always been on acute interventions. You have an injury, you get a disease, you have a heart problem, whatever. Mm-hmm. Let's treat this particular thing. Let's find a way to do that.
And then see you later. Because people didn't live as long as they do now.
So what you're saying now is that medicine needs to refocus, expand its focus to the treatment of chronic issues.
To prevent disease.
That are predictable and knowable, mm-hmm. and that a lot of which involve lifestyle changes. Some of it involves knowing that you're at genetic risk, and we just need mm-hmm. to monitor it mm-hmm. and do the best we can, mm-hmm. like you were saying about.
Or treat it. Like if you have genetic high blood pressure,
right.
then you need to take blood pressure medicine
to bring your blood pressure down
to normal.
But then you still tell me there are lifestyle concerns that even if you're taking that high blood pressure medicine, you need to work on keeping your weight down, work on exercising.
Not eating too much carbohydrate. And not developing diabetes like 50%
right.
of our population.
Yeah.
I mean, 50% being obese creates inflammation. Having a lot of fat gives you a high inflammatory profile. So that in itself is causing you to get plaque on your blood vessels.
Right.
So that is one of the things that we really try to work on. And most of the time, by the time you've gained weight to be considered obese or not morbidly obese, but obese, you have an abnormal insulin resistance. You have abnormal, maybe blood sugar. Mm-hmm. So these are the things that basically we look at and try to counteract
long-term ongoing
with
chronic
diet and exercise.
That evolve, yes.
So, but it's changing your life. I mean, you have to think about, when am I going to exercise today? I'm going to go to the store. What am I going to buy? Am I going to buy chips and dip, or am I going to buy fresh food and actually make salads?
My wife was talking the other day. We were in a grocery store, and she was laughing because we now regularly make the outside circuit. We don't go on the inside aisles almost ever.
Unless we're looking for spices and maybe soup,
for greens and fresh things,
mm-hmm.
Dairy products, whatever that we tend mm-hmm. to buy. Are on the outsides.
They're simple foods.
Yeah.
Whole foods.
So you modify the way you shop.
Right.
And the way you consume.
I mean, it takes thinking. It isn't really more expensive because the processed foods are very expensive. The mm-hmm. chips and the dip and all the junk.
Factor in the health consequences.
Right. Well, they're immediately more expensive, but they're also really more expensive if you're thinking about spending your life in a doctor's office.
Right. That's what I'm saying. As much as I love melted cheese dip and chips, I rarely eat it anymore. I
mean, that's right.
Once a year, maybe.
You know, today we didn't get to talk about how I like to diagnose heart disease and
how to talk about that.
Let's talk about that
next time
in our next episode because that's really important. I mean, to me, it's more important than knowing your risk factors because risk only means it's possible. It doesn't mean it's happening.
So let's summarize what we've talked about today. We've talked about cholesterol is not a one-piece information that identifies risk for heart disease.
Right.
We've talked about statin drugs, which have negative side effects, especially over a long-term period, but which you may need to take to keep you alive and avoid the heart consequences.
In certain circumstances.
And we've talked about shifting the focus of medical treatment from acute to include chronic potential issues.
Right.
All right. So hopefully those are things that you and your physicians are aware of and will continue to become more aware of as you age. Because with the population bubble getting older, these things are going to become vividly important to all of us. Thanks for listening.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.